both of us are stable. And
we have been for a while.
And for quite a while. And I think we come now for the giving back. And because I know I wanted this group so badly. I cried for it. I didn't fit anywhere else. And this was a group that I felt I fit into. My name is Susan Toth. I was diagnosed 8.5 years ago, immediately with metastatic breast cancer. And I immediately felt that I didn't belong anywhere where I was sent for a group. You know, they had a group for women with breast cancer, and I just didn't fit. And everybody was horrified where my disease was, because they would expect or were thinking that they might get there, and they just don't want you there. And Vivian, who is our founder, Vivian Rabinovich, I would cry to her that there has to be something for us. And she had the courage to push for it and start it. And that was 8.5 years ago.
My name is Laurie Greenspoon. I was diagnosed in 2003. And I had 4 surgeries in a month in June. I was a teacher for 31 years, and that was my vacation. I came to the hospital. And they at the time, it was stage 0. They thought I had like a little 2-centimeter tumor. And then as each surgery progressed, it got bigger. So that was the tip of the iceberg. And then when I did a bone scan in August, because that was the protocol at the time, I lit up like a Christmas tree. I had tumors from my neck all the way down to my sacrum, 18 tumors. So my surgeon actually cried. She cried. They gave me 18 months. I always said that I just didn't believe it. When I was first diagnosed, I had a friend of mine from school with me, because everybody, my family was out of town, and she said, "You came out and they told you had breast cancer." You said, "Gee, I don't have time for this. I have a lot of things I have to do." And I just kept doing them. And I never believed for a minute that I was going to die, but everybody else thought. But I had a lot of doctors who really, they look at you and they don't even want to waste their time treating you because they figure you're not going to be around long enough. Why bother? It's very sad.
We are so different. We really are. When you have breast cancer and you know, you're stage 0, stage 1, 2, 3, it kind of, there's a part where there's treatment and then life goes on. For metastatic, it does not. You're constantly being monitored. There's always some sort of drugs. It's pretty rare to be without drugs. And so you just don't fit into the group of women who are kind of go on with life in a different fashion.
The sad thing about metastatic disease is we're never going to get better. Quote, we're not going to be in remission, or we can't say, I always say, people say, so you're fine now? Because if you look fine, they think you're fine. I say, I'm surviving. I'm not a survivor. I'm surviving. Because every day, for most people, I don't know about you, it's hard for them to understand metastatic disease. And I always say it's like I have a big bad giant inside of me that's sleeping. Yeah. And we have to keep him sleeping. But he can wake up whenever he feels like it. And that's scary.
Education is so important that you have to certain times demand that you might want something other than what they recommend, because I want to fight harder. I'm younger now. I want to fight this in a different mode than you've decided for me. And this was my case, where I had to demand that I don't just want to have drugs. I want to have actually chemo. Treat me like I'm not about to die. And it was tough, because it's tough to go against our oncologist.
Yes, because you're not the doctor. And the problem with metastatic disease, usually the protocol is hormones. They give you hormones. They don't give you chemo, because they figure it's already progressed past the chemo stage.
Yeah.
But that's usually the protocol.
I had a doctor who gave me a referral for radiation. To this day, I bless that doctor, because she was the only doctor that looked at me and said, "You're not dying." Because everybody else said I was the guy that died. She said, "You're not dying." And I bless her. And I still go to her for the last 8 years, once a year, to see her.
She's your breast doctor?
She's my breast radiation oncologist. And I started to believe maybe I'm not dying. It's maybe I'm going to be here for a while.
We are. We are. And she became a grandmother, yeah. And I did too. So if these are things, you know, you look at life very differently. Yeah. You are very happy to be 60, where most people complain bitterly, and you appreciate every day.
You really do. I bless her. Every year when I walk in January, I say to her, thank you. Thank you for those words. You have no idea what that meant to me. But why I'm here, I don't know. I don't know if it's that or what. That I have no answer to. But it sure as heck makes a difference to hear that those words from somebody.
The worst is when you first, people don't know what to say to you.
True.
They just look at you and they just don't know. My daughter used to get, they would ask her, you know, how are you? How are you? And then they would get the head tilt. And how's your mother? The voice would change. And how's your mother? And of course, you know, now they still look at me. But one of my good friends, when I told her I had breast cancer, she says, I'm so sorry. And that was the nicest thing anybody could say to me because it sucks, you know? You don't want to, but most people just have no clue. They don't know what to say. The thing that bothers me the most, I don't know about you, is people who say, oh, you've got a good attitude. That's why you're still alive. I say, that's a crock, okay? Because I've known many people.
Positive. Yeah, positive. Always positive.
Yeah, always positive. It's garbage. It said it's all about get the right drug and you're here. You don't, you're dead.
The drug that works.
Yeah.
Get the drug that actually works. And your body reacts.
It reacts
well to it.
Usually the way the format goes in our group is we share our story. We tell them how long we've been here. And usually when they hear 8 years or 9 years, their eyes light up. I remember Georgina was sitting there last week and we were talking about, I'm on Herceptin because I have the HER2 new gene like she does. And there's about 25% of breast cancers with that gene. And before Herceptin, we died. So she heard I had 108 treatments and her eyes lit up. And I gave her hope. And sometimes we've lost many members in our group. And I remember one time, it was Angela. Angela was diagnosed at 28. She had two children. And her goal was to see her children raised.
And age 18, let her son become 18 years old.
And she died last year. Was it last
two
year,
years,
two years
right,
ago?
2 years.
And it was so hard because she was a very up, positive, flamboyant person, a funny girl. And that day when we saw her was the first time that she really was down. And I had spoken to Sue and I said, I was devastated. She says, we go to give other people hope. And sometimes it's very difficult to drag yourself here. When you're feeling okay and then you see other people. Francine, we just lost two people just over the holidays, over Christmas. We come back and they're, you know, in a couple of weeks they're gone. So it's very difficult to keep pulling out that. But again, we come because we're doing okay. And I always call myself Hope in a Bottle. They always, from Hope and Cope, they give me people. They contact me, will you talk to this person? And I try to tell them what I've done. And I always say, you have to be more selfish when you're sick. You have to think about you. I was told 9 years ago, you can't exercise anymore. And I loved the gym because I could paralyze myself and you can't go back to work. And I also love my job. But you find, and now I say, how did I ever have time to work? Because cancer's a full-time job if you take care of yourself and you want to live. And I think the hope, giving it to others, and then it gives it back to you also. Because it also makes you feel better if you help people.
Yeah, it does.
It really does.
That's the beauty of it. That you get something back when you enlighten someone. And the gift that gives you is phenomenal. I really feel that it helps me. Like friends of mine, family will always say, are you sure it's not too much? Because they know when people die around us. And I mean, I share it with them. And they always say to me, you sure? You sure?
I have a friend like that too.
I just say, you know what? I wanted this group so badly. There's no way I'm going to give it up. I don't know when I'm going to need them, maybe.
Yeah.
And right now, they need me. And I just, there's something so special that I can offer. And what else is there?
Because this is the only place where people actually understand. because they're the same. Most people haven't a clue. They say, oh, but they don't. Even your husband, they really don't understand what it's like to live and have it's sort of like a black cloud over your head all the time. But that's the reality.
Yeah, the weight on your shoulder, that's what it is. Yeah. It's a weight. I find that it kind of can really push you down. But, you know, you gotta find all this beautiful stuff that's around us still. You know, life and family and friends, and I am very blessed.